Thank you very much, Professor Gortenbosch. I can't tell you how pleased I am to be at this very historic occasion to celebrate the 200 years of Presidency College. You may not see someone who is likely to be connected to Presidency College, but let me begin because I'm a historian. I love historic occasions, and when I attend a historic occasion, a ceremony like this, all the worst in me as a historian comes out, and I keep on thinking about the past. And I must say that remembering my own past, I was recalling the fact that when I was in primary school, I was taught by an Indian teacher whose name was Mr. Sengupta. And one of the things he taught me about was about the University of Calcutta as being the first great university in Asia. He was himself never been at the university, but he spoke very fondly of it, and he mentioned to me the origins of the University of Calcutta as coming from a great reformer, Ram Mohan Roy, and the beginnings of Hindu College, which has now become Presidency College and then now Presidency University. So this goes back a long, long time because I'm a pretty old man. But in those days when he talked about this, he already spoke about the fantastic achievements of the people of Bengal. And he spoke very proudly of all the achievements of the Bengalis who went to Presidency College. I remember he mentioned Subhash Chandra Bose. And then, of course, all of you are aware that he was very much associated with my part of the world, which was Malaya during the war. And so, as I grew up, my sense of India became very much influenced by that very simple background of being told about the University of Calcutta. It was the first university that I heard about in my primary school, apart from those that the Europeans talked about, those of Oxford and Cambridge and so on, that every colony of the British would have heard about. So, apart from that, in Asia, University of Calcutta was my first university in my mind. And of course, Ram Mohan Roy Hindu College was the connecting link with the University of Calcutta. For myself, I've been around a bit, and I've been to many universities. I started out in a university in China, a university in Malaya, when it was first founded, but I have to say that when I went to my University of Malaya, it was the first year of the university, so as you can imagine, a very, very young university. And then I went on to Australia, I went to Britain to study, I went on to Australia to work, and then to the University of Hong Kong before returning to my alma mater, the University of Malaya, which now is the National University of Singapore. This background, just to illustrate the fact that as a historian, I'm always very concerned about being asked to talk about the future. So when I was asked to talk about the future of universities, I was very reluctant to do that, but I must confess that when Professor Bose approached me about that, what drew me here was not about the future of your university, but the past of your university as a historian. I was so delighted to be associated with that history of your 200 years. But at the same time, I'm also aware that while the future is uncertain, and I've had the privilege this morning of hearing my British speakers talk about the future and what we hope it might be, what we hope we can do to match the expectations of the future. The future is uncertain, and we all more or less accept that. Even though we like to dream about it, and plan for it, and hope for better things, we know that it is uncertain. But most people forget that actually the past, the history, is also very uncertain. There are no certain facts about history. History is what we construct in our own minds, and what we do to construct the past is very much and very often influenced by what we hope for the future. And so in that sense, being asked to talk about the future of universities drew me to think about what do we know about the past of universities and to what extent that past might still be relevant to us when we think about the future. I can't say that I have any answer, but I'm going to offer to you at least my particular experience of how I have selected bits of the past to try and explain what that past class means for us, but behind it all, I do recognize that I probably have a sort of uncertain future in mind when I'm trying to construct the past to help me understand or help me look to the future. So I think the past is useful in that way. And I imagine that when Professor Bose and the Vice Chancellor invited me as a historian to talk about the future, they probably also understood that these historians tend to be like that. They use the past selectively to help them construct something that might possibly help them understand the future. Well, I hope what I offer will do a little bit for you in that sort of way. I look back at the past in this way. In 1991, at the centenary of the University of Chicago, I had the privilege of being there with some very fine historians who talked about history of universities. And in that case, they were talking about history of universities and what that meant. And one of the speakers, unforgettable, was a professor, Walter Rigg of Switzerland, who was then known to be the historian of the universities in Europe. He was in fact in the middle of a big project to write the histories of the universities of Europe, eventually bringing out four very important volumes tracing that history. But what he said at that occasion really shook me and made me think very hard about universities. I was by that time president of university, vice chancellor of the University of Hong Kong, and I thought I knew what a university meant. But when I heard him say it very clearly and very convincingly in the course of his lecture, he said, universities are European. And the spread of universities around the world is a kind of Europeanization of the world. And he meant it perfectly sincerely, as he explained why he thought that. And to some extent, we are observing that, whether we talk in terms of the Industrial Revolution, the modern university, the research universities, the fantastic contributions of universities to the development of the United States of America, for example, the most powerful and richest country in the world. We do see, behind it all, a fantastic number of very successful and great universities. So he was not wrong in projecting that. In fact, he made it very clear, as eventually the books came out, the four volumes came out, two volumes about the pre-modern age and two volumes about the period after 1800, the rise of the modern universities. And the case for the modern university as being European was extremely convincing, and I had no problems with that. What really shocked me was his further explanation that these universities were possible, and the structure, the imaginative way the universities evolved, the way it actually determined its future, the way it determined the parameters of how it should develop and so on, derived from the ancient traditions of Greece and Rome and all the traditions of, as it were, the Mediterranean civilization that he said was a source of this inspiration of the modern university. And that made me pause. Here was I, working in a modern university in Asia, a product of the modern university in Asia, and accepting it as being a major step forward in the progress of humankind, as it were, being told that all these had to be derived, as it were, from an ancient tradition which was not part of our world in Asia, made me think twice about what I understood about universities. Could we really take over a model of the university that is, as he explained it, deeply rooted in the culture and traditions of the Mediterranean civilizations that we are not part of, at least not of us in Asia? So it made me look back, and here's where my selective historical account comes from. Look back to see what it is in us that either makes us good students of this model, the European model, or whether we will be failed exemplars or failed practitioners of this model because our traditions, the origins of our values and our systems of thinking are so different and rooted in something else. Is that possible, that we will just copy and never make much of it? Or can we actually make something of it even though our roots, our own traditions, are totally different? So that has led me to offer some thoughts on this. Let me take it simply from the area that I know best. I come from Southeast Asia. I was born in Java, grew up in Blair, and then started to study mainly China, the East Asian civilizations. Knowing a little bit about the Indian civilization through my teachers and my friends who I grew up with in Blair, but really superficial, but much more Southeast Asia and China. So I look back and I say to myself the following. In Southeast Asia, the origins of our culture in Southeast Asia is very closely linked with that of India. And we often read about the reasons for this. And there's been a tremendous debate going on, years and years, in fact decades now, and there hasn't been real unanimity about unanimous conclusions about what is the reason for the what has been called the Hinduization or Indianization of Southeast Asia. Of course it is true. If you look around India, and many people have commented on it, and Professor Bose has quoted Rabindranath Tagore referring to it when he made his first visit to our part of the world. And it was extremely significant. It led to a tremendous amount of literature on that very phenomenon of India, a sort of India in Southeast Asia. And yet we really don't know how that came about. And it is truly remarkable the extent and degree and intensity of that influence of India on Southeast Asian cultures and traditions, of which we have no proper records and no clear evidence of how it actually occurred. So there has been a lot of speculation, a lot of efforts to try and explain it all, and basically belonging to two main groups. One is that there's a much more active, proactive role that Indians played in bringing their culture and civilization to Southeast Asia, and the others being there's a kind of local indigenous genius that looked to India and found the things that really stimulated their imagination. And they willingly and happily took it and turned it into something that would suit their needs. In other words, localizing through their own genius what they had taken, ideas, institutions, values, artistic, architectural genius of the Indians, and brought it to Southeast Asia and created their own examples of it. Examples which you all know about, like Borobudur or Angkor Wat, which are extraordinarily familiar to an Indian face, but yet at the same time, very distinctive. Nothing like Borobudur has yet been found in India, nothing quite like Angkor Wat has been found in India, and yet at the same time, one look at them, you say, they must have come from India. At least the inspiration had come from India. Now that's very obvious. So why do we know so little about it? Why was it so mysterious and so lost in time, as it were? The fact is that it happened, as it were, almost like osmosis. There was no violence, there was no war, there was no missionary, at least as far as we can tell, we can't find any evidence of missionary, continuous, systematic missionary efforts to convert the Southeast Asians to an Indian worldview. We have no evidence of that at all. So what we saw was a cultural transfer that was extremely peaceful, took a long time, but thoroughly ingested and internalized by the peoples of Java and Cambodia, Champa and elsewhere, and from it sprouted their own artistic and architectural response to what they thought, what they imagined, what they considered to be the soul and spirit of the Indian values that they had been inspired by. So what we have is something like that. And we have no other reason to disbelieve this very long-term but sympathetic understanding of two cultures and one culture transferring, as it were, to the other without any known media that we can actually identify. So that's one. Secondly, it led me to think about China's response to the coming of Buddhism. There's another example, an extraordinary example, of a few monks traveling from Central Asia, some of them not even necessarily Indians, but Central Asians, but a mixture of Indians and Central Asians, carrying the message of the Buddha across the deserts to China, And then taking, the fact is that these ideas took root very, very systematically over a period of several hundred years, by the end of which the majority of the Chinese people were deeply influenced by those ideas that the monks and missionaries brought with them to China nearly 1,000 years ago. There was no systematic one. We don't see any systematic sending of missionaries, no systematic effort to convert the Chinese or to force the Chinese to accept any alien ideas. Not at all. It was primarily once the ideas arrived in China, the Chinese people, exactly how it happened, we do have some records of that, but the Chinese people responded gradually, and as they got more and more absorbed by the freshness of those ideas, the fact that they, in their own society, found that these ideas were absent in their own roots, began to accept them and then gradually take them into their own system and eventually influencing the system of ideas in China itself, until the two become, as it were, totally merged into one. Quite an extraordinary experience. Again, let us say very clearly, like the experience in Southeast Asia, no wars, no fighting, no compulsion. And in fact, Chinese monks went to China, to India regularly. And we've heard the mention of Nalanda. Nalanda was such an inspiration that we have Chinese records, probably even more firm records of Nalanda than anybody else, about the fact that these priests and monks went all that way to seek the truth, to seek the sutras, bring the true message of the Buddha back to China, to make sure that their understanding of Buddhism is not the wrong one, make sure they will be correct. And not only that, we also discovered that they were using Southeast Asia for doing that. They were not only doing it across the land, although the messages first came to China across overland, the monks also went overseas. They came to Southeast Asia on the way to India, and then we discovered that in Southeast Asia, in Srivijaya, already there were schools of teaching, not only of the languages like Sanskrit and the relevant languages for reading the Buddhist sutras, but those who are actually teaching the sutras themselves, the ideas behind it. And we get this from the records of the Chinese priests, Chinese monks who went there. What we then see is that both by land and by sea, all these connections were meeting without any violence, without any force or compulsion. I emphasize that because what follows becomes quite different. In fact, just before that, I mentioned that at the time, about not long after the Buddhist monks went to China, there were others bearing other religious symbols also came to China. We have examples of the Zoroastrians, or the Manichaeists, the Nestorian Christians, the Jews, and finally the Muslims. All arrived from the 6th and 7th century onwards to China, soon after the Buddhist monks had gone there. But they too brought their own messages. They too had fresh ideas and so on. But for some reason, the Chinese did not accept any of them. And this is itself a fascinating subject that many scholars have spent a lot of time trying to understand. They didn't accept it. But what they took from Buddhism, they took very voluntarily and deeply absorbed it into their system. But all the later ones who came did not have that kind of reception. Was it because the Chinese had already found enough in Buddhism and satisfied with that and no longer needed anything else that was new? We don't know. But the fact is that all the others did not have the same reception. So Islam and Christianity in its earlier forms that arrived in China simply did not. They arrived very peacefully, and they did not have the kind of reception that Buddhism was receiving. But what we see then, after the modern age, starting from the commercial empires of the 16th century onwards, in Southeast Asia, I concentrate on Southeast Asia now, in Southeast Asia we see a number of things happening. By that time, for various reasons, again subject of many scholarly debates, Islam came to replace very steadily and then very rapidly the Hinduism and Buddhism of the islands of Southeast Asia. The Nusantara, we call them in our part of the world. The Malay world of all the islands that is part of Southeast Asia. Almost none survived, except we all know about Bali. Almost the others none survived. Islam simply replaced the Hindu-Buddhist ideas that had been prevalent for nearly 1,000 years or more. That is remarkable. At the same time, Christianity came. And this time coming not, interestingly enough, not through the Portuguese and the Dutch, who didn't bother too much to spread the word, but came with the Spaniards coming from the other side of the Pacific, from Latin America, from Mexico, Spain and Mexico, and then in the Philippines, establishing a new world, of a Christian world, in the middle of Southeast Asia. Well, not in the middle, maybe really on the edge, but nevertheless they did so with great success, and it's still the Catholic part of Southeast Asia today. But in that case, there was violence, there was power, there was actually administration and the supremacy of the church in converting just about everybody in the Philippines they could get hold of to become Catholics. It's on record. They have proudly recorded their successes, and we know that to be true. And thereafter, there has been a completely different approach to it all. Now talking about, this brings me back to the universities. I use that as a measure of how these cultural transfers took place. I had mentioned them as being very peaceful in the past, but from now onwards, there was a direct connection between successful cultural transfers with wealth and power. The wealth that is necessary for the kind of power that brought the West to our part of the world, but wealth and power became a very important part of this transfer. But is it really cultural transfer that we're talking about? Let me now take it from that period to the modern times. In modern times, what we have seen in the last 200 years, for example, and this brings me back to Presidency College in its original Hindu college form, that was in 1817. In 1817, most people would argue that Singapore was but a swamp, and part of the Johor Empire, very much neglected, had been once important, but we don't really know much about it. But starting from that, 2 years later, Raffles picked Singapore to be a base for the British Empire. But as I said, in 1817, when you had your Hindu college, with nothing but a swamp in Singapore. So with a modern university, if I take it from there and I can one can expand, take it further, in 1857 when the three great universities of India were launched, Calcutta, Mumbai and Madras, again from outside where I grew up, these were the three model modern universities of Asia that we were hoping to become ourselves, hoping to model ourselves on. When those were established, they were established in a particular context. It was established in the context of the wealth and power of the British Empire. Whether we identify which part of it, we may not agree about which part of that British Empire appealed to the Indians more, but whatever it was, those three, led by British teachers, British professors, British experts, had in fact brought, and I think the Indian people willingly accepted it, as these are symbols and practices of the most modern country in the world. Great success. Elsewhere in Asia, there are no similar responses. Nobody volunteered to attend the universities. But 20 odd years later, when the Japanese discovered that the power and wealth of the West was something they greatly admired and would like to copy, like to reproduce in Japan, and it would turn Japan away from being a subordinate culture to the Chinese and have its own independent, as it were, existence, would express themselves better if they could take from the West the secrets of wealth and power that made the West so powerful. And the University of Tokyo was established, 1876 more or less they started, and it was a great success, followed soon after by University of Tokyo, one after the other. They were all set up by the national purposefulness of the Meiji Restoration. A restoration which was based on the idea of gaining wealth and power for Japan after years of being, as it were, secondary to the power of China. And it was, again, understood very clearly. Universities were linked with wealth and power. If, of course, at the same time, it is also making, bringing about progress and new ideas and so on, that's fine. But ultimately, all those new ideas are valuable only because they contribute towards the wealth and power that these countries, that Europe had achieved and Japan wanted to achieve. In fact, what Walter Gregg was saying, the modern university's great success was that it was, at least in the eyes of others as well as of themselves, the symbol of the wealth and power that followed the Industrial Revolution and the modernization and enlightenment project that they sold to the world. So the Japanese got that message first of all the Asians. I'm not even sure the Indians responded quite that way. The Japanese responded very clear-cut. And it was a national purpose thing, done as it were through the restored Meiji Emperor and a new goal of becoming the most powerful and wealthy nation in Asia. And they were very successful. There was no question for the next 50 years they were leading the whole of Asia in seizing upon the opportunities offered by the Western messages, the secret of Western success, as it were brought to Japan, and they fulfilled it in a matter of one or two generations. And they did so very clearly by the way they defeated China and a number of wars. They took over from the West, in fact, in becoming the more powerful and aggressive force in Asia against China at the time. And we know the history of it. I don't want to go into that. But it's interesting that the Chinese responded after being defeated by Japan by a very aggressive effort to model themselves on the Japanese experience and build their universities. The modern university in China began right at the end of the 19th century and it was clearly modeled on the University of Tokyo, even though the Chinese never said so in so many words. When you look at the structure of the new universities in China, they were very much influenced, deeply influenced, by what they saw to be the Japanese success in taking Western models and turning them into Japanese institutions. And the Chinese thought they could do the same. They would have to do the same if they were going to able to stand up to the Japanese in the future, because they had been defeated by Japan. In short, I'm arguing that it was wealth and power that drew the Chinese to take the Japanese example, and the Japanese had taken the example from Europe a few decades earlier. So this was the driving force. What we are talking about today, about knowledge, contributions to human well-being, the universities as a force for progress and so on, was also there. But I'm not sure to what extent that was seen as being a goal in itself in those early days. To a large extent, they were functions of the national needs of each country, whether they were Britain, France, or Germany, in Europe, and other countries. But the driving force behind it, seemed to me anyway, a great deal of it, was the need for each country to be strong enough or to be stronger and richer than its neighbors. And that was what drove them in Europe. And I'm afraid in Asia, the example of Japan and China illustrates that very well. I'm not sure this applies to India, but I would like to think about that, and I invite you to help me think about that. But in terms of East Asia, China and Japan falls into that particular model. The search for wealth and power through knowledge to enable these countries to rise, first of all to defend themselves against the West, the aggressive West, but later on hope that they would themselves become powerful enough to awe everybody else, as it were. Southeast Asia, let me go back to Southeast Asia. We're a real mixed area altogether. I mentioned Islam and Christianity earlier on, but in fact there's more to that. There was the Buddhism, the Theravada Buddhism of the mainland part of Southeast Asia, Burma, Thailand, Cambodia, where the Hinduism gave way to Theravada Buddhism instead of to Islam in the island world. Very interesting in itself, the subject of many, many writings, many attempts to explain it all, but not really very easy to grasp altogether. And in fact, no clear conclusions as to why one lot, as it were, went to Theravada Buddhism, the other lot went to Islam in that Hinduized world that Southeast Asia had become. Anyway, to skip that part, come down to modern times. Every part except Thailand were colonized in one way or the other. Even Thailand was deeply influenced by Anglo-French power on the mainland. But in the colonies, there were no universities to begin with. I mean, the first university in the British Empire was Hong Kong on the borders of China, and then Rangoon next to India. And that was because of the influence of India in Rangoon in 1919. But the Dutch didn't do anything either. The French in Indochina didn't do anything either. Only in the Philippines, which is very interesting. In the Philippines, there had been, as it were, the Catholic universities, the theological, pre-modern universities that the Catholics brought to Manila, and we had the Santa Thomas University, which still exists today, very different kind of university from what it was when it was set up in the 17th century. But nevertheless, the continuous development of Santa Thomas as a Catholic theological center down to a modern university that it is today, itself a fascinating story. But in Southeast Asia, that was the only exception, and it was not a modern university until after the Americans took over the Philippines in 1900. And it was the Americans who converted them all to an American type of university, which all the universities in the Philippines now more or less belong. And the colonial universities were modeled on the various colonies eventually. As I mentioned earlier on, I was a freshman in a brand new university of Malaya, but not built until 1949, on the eve of the British departure, as it were. Sort of one of the last gifts they would give to us before they left. But what is interesting is there's no question of cultural transfer whatsoever. My understanding of all these universities that I spoke of, apart from the Catholic ones, which are pre-modern, the modern universities, there was no question of cultural transfer. What was important was the technological transfer. Technological transfer, to learn all the methods that the West had perfected and improved, and made tremendous progress with, take them, all of them, learn from them, maybe copy them, and improve on them, so that we too can have wealth and power. That was the sort of overall image that one has of all these universities. But in Southeast Asia, there weren't any, because there were more colonies, and the colonial power had no reason to want to encourage us, the locals, to want to build their own wealth and power against it, so there's no encouragement. If anything, the colonial colleges and schools that were eventually became universities all started with, I would call it, service training. They were service training to enable some of the local indigenous and local people to be able to serve the colonial masters in the menial and other less important clerical jobs that were necessary in their colonies. But anyway, that was the beginning. And it's from that that we had the new universities in Burma, Malaya, and eventually after the war, the universities in Indonesia, curiously enough, were soon modeled upon those of the Dutch universities, and once in Indochina, very much influenced by the universities in France. So all of us looked to, as it were, metropolitan examples to provide means of getting started. It's a long story, so I won't go into that. What I'm trying to say, as you can see, the reasons for all this all had to do with the fact that the post-1800 world was one that was determined in the eyes of many, particularly from those from outside, that all that the West stood for was wealth and power. The materialism underlying it all was what impressed us most, because that seemed to have brought them the kind of progress that none of us had ourselves been able to develop from within our own resources. And that's the background. You can see I've been selective, because as I said, I'm thinking about the future. Since the Vice Chancellor asked me to talk about the future of universities, what would the futures of universities in Asia be like if that is the past? And I've selected them very carefully to show that what had been before was entirely voluntary, selectively picked by indigenous peoples of the ideas they liked from abroad, and internalizing them and making them their own. But the last 200 years, however, we have models which are based on success of wealth and power elsewhere. We want to reproduce it in our part of the world. Now, some of us are idealistic enough, and I think you heard them earlier this morning, who want to believe that all of us can contribute to the knowledge it would be good for all mankind. I think that is good. That's many people in universities, thank goodness, think like that, and very peacefully, and have great, bring great hopes to humanity in general. But underlying it all, and this comes back to the Vice Chancellor's very fundamental question, which all universities face almost anywhere in the world. Funding. Where's the money coming from? Who's giving us the money? What are they giving us the money for? All these things. So, all these things now come to the fore, and we are faced with that question. And then we see how in Asia, whether it was Japan and China leading the way earlier on, in Southeast Asia, when we all became nation states after the departure of the colonial powers, each one of us wanted to be a nation state with its own capacity to do, bring wealth and power, not maybe not a lot of power because they're all very small states, but certainly wealth and well-being to our people. All of us are emphasizing these aspects of the wealth and power aspect of modern knowledge and of the role of the university. Professor Bailey very eloquently talked about what the government has been doing with Yale and US knowledge and all the other things that the Singapore government does. But let's face it, that is national policy. That's a government purposefully setting out to do what they think would make the Singapore people, the people of Singapore, ready to face the modern world, to face the future, using the university as a means to build the future. And taking all the good examples they can find from Yale, from Harvard, from Oxford, Cambridge, from all over the world, from Japan, to try and somehow tinker with the system, university system, to work out how best to create for Singapore and the people of Singapore, not only the university that will do best, but a country that will benefit directly from the university education you receive. The message here to me is very clear. Again, it is that national purpose, a political and economic goal that the nation state, or whatever is the government of any state, wants to better itself and make its country work better. Of course, this is a nation state world, at least up to now. One of my favorite pastimes is to dream of a world in which nation state is not the basic unit of change, but that's a kind of dream. In the meantime, we have nation states. And here is where I have great difficulties in imagining the future of the university in India, to be honest. I find it difficult because India is, as explained earlier on in the morning, a complex place, different nation states, in fact, almost different nation states, each with its own driving force, developing a different pace. I was really struck by a very eloquent statement, a very passionate statement about this earlier on. And it does make me really puzzled. What is the future of the university in Asia? Are we talking about universities, or different varieties of universities? I'm not quite sure now. But you can see when I'm looking at the past, I was really thinking of the future. Because I'm trying to find something in the past that would help me imagine the future, help me think about what the future of university will be like. I understand fully what has been put to me, the alternatives, the liberal arts college, the professional school, the question of various disciplines, how they can help each other interact and not be isolated from one another, or how that all will help to improve our ability to deal with the future, the uncertain and unknowable future. So all that is there. So let me conclude by saying, we do have that problem. We have, at the moment, a model which is basically secular, materialist, aimed at bringing about social harmony in order to unite everybody for one purpose, which is wealth and power. And I don't mean power nationally, only by national power, but the power to do things, wealth and power, to be able to be masters of your own destiny, so to speak. That is what a secular university does. We have real problems with what is a scientific outlook, and what is a humanities background and traditions that we have. Remember my point about Walter Rieck saying that the European university is rooted in the traditions of the Mediterranean civilizations. Since we don't have the Mediterranean civilizations as part of our tradition, how can we really learn from these European universities and make them, as it were, our own, without drawing upon or without reference to our own traditional values and so on. Which leads to the final point, which was also mentioned, and that is the fact that all these materialistic goals and so on have left a lot of people uneasy and uncertain about themselves, not only about the future of the world, but even about themselves, their own identity as human beings, their spiritual life, their sense of ethical behavior, their codes of behavior in their own societies, as each one of us are encouraged to compete, to fight for the best part of the cake, as it were, to learn to be better than everybody else, to win over others. All these qualities are understandable. They are what made the West progress, progressive, and so successful. But if we all did that, but without reference to our own traditions, our own spiritual and ethical backgrounds and so on, are we getting anywhere? Or are we ultimately the losers? Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Wang Gungwu, for that marvelous lecture on cultural transfers, but also on the nature of universities in Asia. Let me open up for a few questions. Charles Bain in here has the first question, and we will see how long we can go. We of course have the ceremony.
So I want to thank you for a fascinating lecture, and in particular for your emphasis on the role of wealth and power in the rise of universities over the past 200 years. I was reminded as I heard you talk about what happened at Yale when the Yale-NUS collaboration was proposed. Many of my colleagues were desperately opposed because they felt that our name and our abilities were precisely being put to use by the Singaporean government, for whom they had a certain kind of distaste. And I remember, I of course spent 5 years of my life trying to do this, and so I argued furiously against them on mostly idealistic grounds, that is to say, that one could, that the wealth and power things were not the most important questions at stake, and that what was important was education and thought and knowledge, and that those could use the wealth and power in order to achieve their own goals. And it occurred to me after this argument that part of my reason for being so idealistic is precisely that I'm an astronomer. Astronomy costs a lot of money, and we build $10 billion instruments and fly them into space for no purpose other than to discover things about the universe. We're looking up, not down. And therefore, my field happens to epitomize, and therefore people like me join it, happens to epitomize the use of wealth and power for the purposes of philosophical exploration. And I think this is one of the contradictions and tensions and challenges that all of us face in developing the universities, is the balance between this kind of intellectual idealism on the one hand and the service of wealth and power. And so I'm glad that we have this colloquy, because I think it brings to light a disagreement or a tension that will always be with us as we develop universities and as cultures develop all over the world.
Thank you for your comment. I think I'm struck by the fact that it was really after wealth and power was assured, a sense of security, comfort, and confidence have been gained and internalized, that you start thinking about helping the rest of the world, as it were. So maybe there's an order to that. It may not be always so, but certainly in the case of Japan is a very good example. I went through that period, wealth and power, primary. But since then, since the end of the war, they were defeated, their original formula has failed them, and they learned the lesson. And now, if you talk to the Japanese scholars and scientists and so on, they are talking about helping the world, making the world a better place, and gaining knowledge to improve the world. And maybe China would be led in the same direction, because so far as they now see university rankings as a kind of global universal enterprise, and they want to be up among the top, they also have to think in terms of what this knowledge is good for, not just for wealth and power for China, but also for the rest of humankind. And that may be the next stage, but I think they require a kind of a kind of security and confidence that Yale has, which others have.
Does a student have a question?
One comment. I think astronomy is not as useless as you are making it to be. The same forces, the same observations that Tycho Brahe or Copernicus or Galileo made, or Newton, make us throw a cannon or send rockets for geosurveillance. The observation of the solar eclipse now that validated Einstein's general theory is used in GPS. The same things that happened in Martian cloud is now being used, the same similar models are now being used to predict global warming. So it's not as usual, as useless as you think, as you're making it appear. But this idea needs to percolate back to the policy. Yes,
okay, the biologist and the astronomer can have their argument later on. Let's have the question.
A very good talk, sir. So I have a question that...
Introduce yourself.
I am Shobhik Shum from Department of Life Sciences. So I have a question that... I have recently gone to the Nalanda University, the ruins of Nalanda University, and found out how astonishing that our culture was. So, and there the Jainism and the Buddhism both were taught together. So, how that Indian culture really, and you are also taught about the fire and events and the Chinese monks who have come. So, how the Indian cultures, without any brutal harm or anything that was to war, how this Indian culture actually, what an effect on China, good effect on Chinese monks?
That's a very good one, a good question, because if you think about it, the West itself is having a crisis in the humanities. And those traditions that I mentioned that Walter Rigg referred to as giving rise to the university, the rise of the university in the West, those classical values and so on themselves are being ignored and minimized today. If you measure it in terms of funding, very little money goes to that and almost nothing. So even there, in Europe itself, in the West itself, it is being threatened. So in a way, we should look at see what they are up against. Maybe we have something to learn from them. But what the possible reaction is what has been suggested by Professor Ray earlier on, and that is the extreme of religious reactions. To return to fundamental religions as a kind of protection against all these sort of threats to the fundamental values they believe in. Islam is in the forefront of all this. Christianity is also fighting back in some ways. And traditionally in India, China, there are many, many people who are resisting in some way or the other without being able to organize themselves in any coherent form yet. But I think there are certainly those reactions. Whether these reactions are good and ultimately bring about anything good for us, I do not know. I'm not sure, because if you look at the reactions of the Islamic world against modernization, against all these wealth and power arguments, in a way they do capture the inner problems that many people face in dealing with the power of modernization, the distorting facts. Modernization does distort your identity and what you've inherited. That's the whole idea, is to change you into something theoretically, become someone better off, richer, more powerful, and so on. So it does something to us. How do we resist it? Do we really want to resist it? And if we resist it, is it the only way to fall back on extreme forms of our tradition, to become kind of a defensive great wall against all progress? It seems to me that is not the way to go. So that's my own impression, my own view. But how to do it without just drawing up, trying to build a great wall against progress? That is, to me, that is part of the uncertainty of the university of the future. Whether the people within the universities can do it on their own, in their own way. Whether the governments behind them or the people who fund the universities are prepared to let them do it without directly benefiting, as well, without them seeing the benefits for their worth and purpose, worth and power purposes, that is a really serious question. And as I said, if the humanities are being threatened in the West, what hope is there for the humanities in our part of the world? What do we do about that? This is the kind of question I have.
There's a question there.
Sir, my name is Shrondipat Mitra. I'm a former student of Sociology Department of Presidency University. Sir, thanks for your brilliant lecture. I was reminded of my undergraduate days in Presidency because when I joined Presidency in 2011 as the student of its first undergraduate batch, I remember whenever Professor Bose used to come to Presidency, he used to repeatedly encourage both the students and the teachers to engage more with the history of Southeast Asia, Far East and Global South. Now, over the years, I have been reading Ray Nikandasan's work, Professor Bose's work, and more recently, Surin Amrit's work. And I'm also eagerly waiting to read Professor Bose's work on Asia. So my question is, how can we, what are the possibilities to engage with this kind of cultural histories or history of South Asia from a space outside the defined space of the institution or outside the curriculum? Because I am asking this question keeping two things in mind. Number one is that because of Dipesh Chakraborty's recent work that how in India the discipline of history was shaped by debates outside the realm of the institution of the university, and also the recent mishappenings at Nalanda. Because if you only said that the future of the universities are uncertain, so what could be the possible ways to engage with things outside the university space?
I think the variations are very great. For what I know, every part of the world seems to respond somewhat differently to that question. So I don't know that there is a simple answer to all of us. And to some extent, it is related to my initial statement that Professor Rueck had emphasized to us that their institutions, universities are drawn from their traditions of the Mediterranean. There's a long, continuous, and almost unbroken history, you might say, God, but almost unbroken history that led to the rise of the universities in the West the way it was. And that the rest of us, we don't have those roots. We are taking the institutions and trying to make these institutions work for us without, as it were, having any roots of its own in our own soil. How do we do that? And does it matter? If it doesn't matter, then there is no cultural transfer. It's just simply technological transfer. And that technological transfer means to me a lot of things are missing. If there's no cultural transfer, then it's pretty much a mechanical, technical skills that we are mastering, which is not that difficult. I mean, frankly, if you look at how the Japanese and the Chinese build up their science and technology, not that difficult. They imitated and copied everything that they learned from the West. Everything that the West had to teach them, they learned very, very quickly. Indians do the same. That part is the easier part. But the cultural transfer part is missing. Does it matter? I feel deeply inside of me that it does matter. But I do not know the answer of how to be able to as it were, shape the universities that would somehow link up with our own roots, without actually destroying the institutions themselves.
Let me take but I want a bit of a gender balance, as Mohandas Pai was also asking for, if there is... go ahead and ask your question.
My name is Amit from the Department of Chemistry. According to me, it is the principles that we follow and the choices that we make determines our future. So my question is, do you think that based on wrong principles such as selfish motives can really give a good future to a university?
He's asking whether selfish motives, by that I imagine he means it's just a question of self-advancement, thinking of one's career. Is that the best way, you know, can that hamper, you know, what a university or education might in fact provide in future life?
I actually do sympathize with the idea that each individual in some way, if he had the genius to do so, can contribute and make a big difference. But in certain societies, that is not available. That route is not available to such an individual. Where the societies are fundamentally collective in their background, in the way they operate, like my examples of wealth and power with the state, the nation state behind it, the role of the individual is subordinated to the needs of that collective will, as it were, to get something done. And therefore, then the selfish purposes may not be appreciated or understood and maybe too easily rejected if it didn't immediately fit in with the goals of the political leaders who have very clear wealth and power goals in their minds, and if it then doesn't automatically fit into their structure, they simply are ignored and left alone. There are many, many examples of this, I'm sure also in India, but very much so in China. We have many, many examples of very, very inventive Chinese over the last 2,000 years who invented various things, but the state paid no attention whatsoever to them, gave them no encouragement, and many of the brilliant ideas simply were lost to the sand. I was fascinated the other day just to be reminded of some very brilliant mathematical formulas which they worked out, which the government said, what does this got to do with us, you know, and completely forgotten. It was 800 years later before somebody could read it and realize that this chap had solved some mathematical problem, which was of no use to anybody. But the man had done it, but not appreciated at all that he had done something really original and really could have been inspiring to other mathematicians had it been supported, had been given the kind of publicity or encouragement that would be possible today. So it's hard to say. There are certain societies in which the individual's role is really minimalized.
Unless there's a question from a woman in the audience that I've seen a hand go up. That will be the final question, and then I'll close with two very quick comments.
Thank you, Professor Gungwu, for that marvelous talk. Very wide-ranging, it makes us think a great deal. I think I share with you this sense of not just uncertainty, but a certain kind of self-restraint when it comes to thinking about the future of the university. My own sense is that we are at the cusp of a certain kind of schizophrenia. A knowledge of the past that has disabled a certain vision of the future. But this need not in itself be a bad thing. And here I want to root my question by asking you, despite the selective study of history that you offer, is it possible for us to see any examples in history, particularly Southeast Asian history, where the question of autonomy has been central to the way in which universities function? With tradition and with individual talent, as you're saying, with that kind of a difficult relationship that often comes through in under nation states. Keeping that order up, I wanted to know if you had any insights to offer on the question of autonomy, both at the individual level, but also at the level of the university and its commitment to knowledge without politics.
The history of academic autonomy, academic freedom is a very complex one, a very long story indeed. Let me say that when I was Vice-Chancellor of the University of Hong Kong, I had considerable autonomy because it was part of a Commonwealth system in which certain ideals about academic autonomy was well respected, and therefore I had no intervention or interference from any political or government forces whatsoever in the 10 years I was in Hong Kong. But I was perfectly aware that once Hong Kong returns to China, and they meet up with a different set of assumptions about behavior, about the nature of individual, the role of individuals, and the nature of the national interest, and so on, that there will be different challenges. Indeed, up to now, of course, the University of Hong Kong has been left alone so far, as far as I know. But the fact is that this is a tension which will remain, and the tension comes from not because they don't have the autonomy. On paper they do, by constitution it does, legislation in Hong Kong itself protects that autonomy. But at the same time, if there's a fundamental cultural problem about autonomy, then it remains a threatened position, not at all secure. And when you look back on it all, the origins of the idea of the autonomous university, even in the West, was a very recent thing, and not at all secure in many, many countries, even in the West. And I know that the United States has probably taken this as far as it possibly can. By words that I don't know of any other part of the world that has gone as far as the United States. But in the countries that I know of, I mean, universities and government institutions in Western Europe, for example, in France and Germany, every professor is a civil servant. I mean, from that point of view, what kind of autonomy can you really be assured of if you're a civil servant of the state? And of course, there's an understanding and there's some cultural sharing of views which protects you up to a point, but only up to a point. When you have a war, when you have conflict between countries, the whole thing is gone. A very famous case of the University of Strasbourg comes to mind. University of Strasbourg was partly German, and then the French took it, and the Germans took it back, and back and forth. And when I read the history of University of Strasbourg, it was absolutely fascinating what the professors had to do. When it became German, they started teaching German, and the whole thing is restructured in the German framework. The French took it back, they had to readjust, as it were. The professors changed, some didn't change, same professors had to change their minds, as it were, to deal with it. So even in Europe, where the autonomy tradition is so strong, and yet, under certain circumstances, it could just be overthrown completely. So I don't know whether there's any way of protecting it.